Hello and welcome to the Black Entrepreneur Blueprint Show. I am your host, Jay Jones. Black Entrepreneur Blueprint was created specifically to educate and inspire Black entrepreneurs to launch, build, and grow successful businesses. Join us as we help build an economic power base in the Black community by promoting business ownership. If you are currently an entrepreneur or want to be an entrepreneur, we invite you to join us every week here at Black Entrepreneur Blueprint.
Welcome to the Black Entrepreneur Blueprint, episode number 305. I'm your host, Jay Jones, and today, family, we have a dynamic episode in store for you. Strap your seatbelts on, get out your pencil and notepad, because you definitely want to take notes on this one. Now, today, we're going to be talking to Mr. Shawn Prez. He's the former VP of promotions for Bad Boy Records and worked alongside Diddy as Diddy built that empire. Now, what we're going to talk about today is Shawn's internship at Bad Boy, his promotion to vice president at Bad Boy, and then parlaying that into his own entrepreneurial success with his company Power Moves, Inc. And also, we're going to talk about the creation of the Global Spin Awards, which are the Grammys for DJs, which he also created. Now, before we get to today's show, I just want to share a few things with the BEB family. First and foremost, I want to welcome all first-time listeners to Black Entrepreneur Blueprint. Welcome to the BEB family. And please stick around until the end of today's show, and I'm going to share all my social media contact information and my resource links, such as the link to my new book, A New Black Wall Street, also besmartbyblack.com and hireblackfreelancers.com. I'll see you guys after the interview. What's up? We are live with my man, Shawn Prez, the CEO, founder of Power Moves, Inc. Shawn, how are you today, brother?
I'm good, Jay. Thanks for having me, brother. Love your platform.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you, man, taking out the time to come on, talk to the Black Entrepreneur Blueprint family. So that name, Shawn Prez, may be familiar to a couple of people, but I'm going to let you tell the BEB family a little bit about your background. Then we're going to get into you working with Bad Boy and Diddy, and we're going to talk about moving to Power Moves, Inc. and what you're doing now. So give us a little background on who is Shawn Prez.
Okay, how far back am I going? Because my story, it feel like I'm a cat. I done had about 9 different lives, especially in terms of my career. So I'll go back to the early days. Shawn Prez is just a kid from the South Bronx. Born and raised in the South Bronx. Loved everything about it. Tough upbringing, no different than most of us. From there, went to college, and somewhere in college, I realized that whatever my life was going to become, it wasn't there on that college campus. And that was the turning point for the trajectory of my entire life, because I always knew I wanted to be successful. I always knew I was going to be successful. But it was taught to me that success was tied around education in the formal sense. You had to go to a 4-year institution, and from there you might go to graduate school, so forth and so on. And when I left school in my junior year, I left with a mission. I was literally on a mission, and I was driven to find my purpose in life. And, you know, this is where God comes in the picture, because when I came home, I bumped into an old friend. He was a DJ. And I had nothing else to do. I was just searching for my purpose in life. And I used to spend all of my time in his basement. And one day he had the harebrained scheme. He was like, Shawn, I'm a DJ. You know a lot of people. Let's do parties. And because I had nothing else to do at that period, I started to do parties. But that was my introduction into being a full-scale entrepreneur, because I had to go out and I had to negotiate deals with the clubs. I had to market and promote my parties. I had to hire staff. I had to make sure the money was accurate at the door and at the bar. People were paid. So it was my introduction, not just into the entertainment and the music industry, which would become a better part of my life, but more important as an entrepreneur.
That's what's up. Yeah, that's funny, man, because a lot of times we think that school, the traditional trajectory, high school, college, maybe grad school, get a good job, work 35, 40 years, you wait to retire at 65 if you make it that long, and that's how you're supposed to live your life, man. So I'm with you, brother. I'm a contrarian. So I did the corporate America thing for a while, but I've been a serial entrepreneur for 20 plus years, man. So I can definitely... Yes, sir. You know, and we're gonna talk about that because it isn't always, you know, coffee and cream. It's
no, it ain't always sweet, Jay. It ain't always sweet.
I know, bro. So let me start off, man. I want to ask you, how did you start working with Diddy and Bad Boy? Because I know if people Google you, they're gonna see a lot of that comes up. So tell us how that played out.
Okay, it kind of picks up from where I just left off. Okay. I was a party promoter. I thought that was going to be my life. Mm-hmm. But here's the trick, right? Because I'm making good money. I'm meeting people. I'm networking. I'm being exposed to the music industry through promoting parties. But in the back of my head, again, it was always pounded in my head. In order to be successful, you had to go the formal route. So I re-enrolled in school locally. And I was doing my parties at night and promoting and doing all that stuff. But while I was in school, I decided to take an internship. Okay. And when I took an internship, it was like, damn, I want to work at a record label. Because I was seeing it from the other side, which was the club space. Right. And then working in the record label, I was like, okay, this is me. This is more who I am. So I took internship number one, didn't get a job. And this is all while going to school. Finally, internship number two, didn't get a job. And these are unpaid internships. And me, my personality, anything that I do, I give it 150%. So when I tell you I was literally going down there and I was working as though I was a paid employee, I was going and put like leaving everything there. Internship right. number three, no job. Internship number four, no job. And finally, I was like, you know, maybe it ain't for me. And I got discouraged. And by that time, you know, I had long since finished college. And I was like, I got to get a job. I look like a degenerate at this point. How many unpaid internships am I going to take? You know, and I'm right. trying to chase this dream of mine, but it wasn't coming to fruition. And then there was a guy who we both know because, you know, I had been into New York City nightlife and I had definitely been trying my best to get in the music industry through internships. Shawn Puffy Combs get fired from Arista Records and he starts this new upstart label called Bad Boy Records. And just by chance, I was frustrated. I was pissed off. I could not get hired to save my life. And I decided, you know, I'll take one more chance at it. One more chance. And literally, I was working a full-time job. I called in sick. I told them, you know, I can't come in today because I wanted to go down there and just feel it out. Because I was like, I can't commit to something again. And just, you know, I'm making full-time money now. And I right, went right. down there, and the moment that I walked in the door, Bad Boy was on 19th Street at that point. It was a very small office, but when I walked in, I saw young brothers and sisters that looked like me. They talked like me. They had this aggressive, aggressive energy about them, and it was all headed by this young African-American musical genius in Puff Daddy at the time, and I literally... did one day of interning, I called my job and said I quit. And I left a full-time job to go back and work for free at Bad Boy Records. And literally 11 months later, I got my first paycheck in the music industry.
Damn, that's what's up, man. See, there's something important that you said, bro. I want all the Black Entrepreneur Blueprint family members, the light bulb need to go off. You did how many unpaid internships, man? How many did you do?
Including Bad Boy, 5.
5. And see, that's what I tell people. Sometimes you got to just immerse yourself into what you want to do and look at the long game. Yeah, you always want to make money, you know, but now you're soaking up the industry. You're learning the business. And now you're going to use that, I'm sure, as your career move forward with your own business. So BEB family, sometimes you got to take a step back in terms of the paycheck to take 2 steps forward, because you got to learn the industry. And the best way to learn the industry is to be in the industry that you want to be in. And like I said, man, that's something that a lot of people don't want to do now. They want to do that instant success where, hey, I got to get paid, instead of investing your time and then being able to level that up, man. So I definitely wanted to bring that up, man. So
you mind now, if I your first jump right there, yeah, Jay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Because
for anybody who is listening right now, Jay just dropped so many jewels on you, and you have to pay attention to what he just said. And in my case, mm-hmm. I was frustrated. I thought I was unhirable. I started to doubt who I was, doubt that I could compete, because nobody saw my value. They wouldn't give me a check for internships. Yeah. But here's how God works. When I finally got in the door at Bad Boy, what I didn't make in terms of a check, I was making an experience. And when I finally got into Bad Boy, I shot up the ranks, because I wasn't just a regular intern coming in. I had years of experience. I had years of working at different record labels, trying to make my mark. My humility was at an all-time high, and my work ethic at the same time was at an all-time high. And within 3 years, I was vice president of promotions at Bad Boy. I skyrocketed through the industry, but it was because I humbled myself and I understood foregoing a check in those early days was just setting me up to rocket. Like that jet fuel that I had when I came into Bad Boy, I wouldn't have climbed through the ranks at the rate that I did had I not had all of that experience. Even though it came at a price, which was no paycheck, I wouldn't change it for the world. So stop thinking I gotta get paid. No. Get in the door. That's what you have to do. Right. Understand that if you are serious about becoming an entrepreneur or getting into a certain industry, you get in the door by any means necessary. And even if that means foregoing a check for now.
Exactly. I'm with you 100%. Thanks for reiterating that, because that's important. I had this conversation with my oldest daughter. She was in the entertainment industry. She was working out in LA she was a page for NBC Universal. Mm-hmm. And so she got out of that about a year and a half ago, and she was like, "Dad, I'm moving to LA. They're only paying me $15 an hour." I said, "But the long game." I said, "You're a page for NBC Universal. You got Matt Lauer. You got all types of media personalities that have gone through that same program, and it's an investment." And sure enough, she's able to parlay that after she did that year in the bigger and better thing. So it was an investment, because living in LA at $15 an hour, that ain't no joke, you know? So my wife and I obviously were helping out, but you know, it was like, yeah, you sacrifice now, you get that, the connections, the work ethic that she showed people, when they say her name, like, oh yeah, we love her, because she was in there getting it. And that's what it's about, man. So I'm glad you really highlighted and brought that out, because that's something that's very important. And I don't care if you're an entrepreneur or if you're working in corporate America, that jet fuel, you know, and that's where you got it from, man. So you moved up to VP of operations, man.
VP of promotion.
Of promotions. I'm sorry. Yep. What was some of the, or one of the biggest lessons that you learned from Diddy, man, just in terms of business?
Well, I say this all the time. For one, I learned... Again, you know, my life, one day I got to write this in a book, right? because all that I didn't learn in school, I learned hands-on. That hands-on training, I'll take that any day of the week, because I literally sat next to, worked alongside, worked with a business mogul that will go down in history, you know, for all time. Mm-hmm. But one of the biggest lessons that I learned was I'm a hard worker, or so I think.
Right.
I'm willing to sacrifice. I am willing to do things that 90% of people who swear to death that they want it so much are not willing to do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But in all of my days of working alongside Sean Diddy Combs, I never once went home thinking I outworked that man.
Damn.
Never once.
Wow.
His work ethic is legendary. Now, granted, there's some people in this world who are just special people. Some people, he, you know, his ability to think, analyze, read a room, manage people, legendary.
Right.
But it, nothing comes close. His success is deeply rooted in his work ethic. He, that whole can't stop, won't stop, sleep is forbidden.
Yeah.
He did not just say that. He lived it. So having him as a barometer day in and day out, even if I didn't quite make it or you know, get to his level in terms of the work ethic, I was light years ahead of the general public.
That's what's up, man. That's and you know what's funny, man? I want to just highlight this too. It's something I say on the show all the time, Sean. It's the difference between knowledge and know-how. So people always say knowledge is power. I said, now you can get knowledge from watching television. You can get knowledge
from reading.
You can get knowledge from reading a book. And so I tell people the analogy. So I said, now if I watch the video on how to fly an F-15 fighter jet, right? You know, I'm getting that knowledge. If I could be in the back seat of the F-15 fighter jet, and you pull the stick up, the plane will go up. You pull it down, it goes down. And I said, now the question is, do you know how to fly the F-15 fighter? So if you put me in that cockpit, we ain't going nowhere, family. So know-how comes from doing. And knowledge can come from any type of, you know, different venue or you know, place. And so that's what I tell people. When you want to be an entrepreneur, you can sit there and write a 300-page business plan. You can go and do all the types of research you want to do, but you don't get anything back. No feedback until you do something. So you got to have the know-how, and that comes from doing. So I'm glad that you mentioned that, man, because I know the BEB family's probably tired of me saying this, because I probably say it once every three or four episodes, but it's so true, man. You got to do the work, and that's how you learn, you know? So yeah, I appreciate you pointing that out, man. I'm going to ask you a question that's kind of similar to the one I just asked you, but what do you think the difference between regular entrepreneurs and versus entrepreneurs like, say, Diddy, Oprah, Bob Johnson, Michael Jordan? What do you think separates them from just, you know, regular successful entrepreneurs?
Vision. It's a few things, but off the top of my head, I'll say vision and a deep-rooted self-belief. So I've had the opportunity to work alongside of the greats. But if we want to stick to Puff, right? Okay. Like, let's just focus in and zone in on him.
Okay.
His vision, you know, I don't even believe to this day that he's reached where he sees himself at. Now, for the average person, you know, Puff has created multiple successful companies, whether it's his record label, clothing company, Ciroc Vodka, so forth and so on. Mm-hmm. But he has this vision of where he is trying to go and the mark that he wants to leave on this earth. Mm-hmm. And he is willing to do whatever it takes to get it. So I think with most entrepreneurs, they don't have a broad scale vision, but, and I know most people are gonna disagree with me, mm-hmm. but if you get them in a room by themselves turn out the lights and it's just them and their thoughts, they don't believe. They don't look in the mirror and say, I can do this. I can be the next Elon Musk. I can be the next Jeff Bezos. I can be the next Russell Simmons. They don't believe it can happen to them. And what they don't realize is all of these people, whether it's Oprah or any of these successful entrepreneurs I just named, they're only human. That's right. Put their pants on one leg at a time. But the difference between them and you is, number one, their vision, their belief, and they're willing to put in the work. And then I'll add this to it.
Okay.
I truly believe some people are just destined for whatever, you know, Michael Jordan was destined to be Michael Jordan. Now, he had to put the work in, but, you know, watching this documentary, the way he moved, his flair, all of that kind of stuff, those are just the intangibles. Working alongside of Puff, Puff had so many intangibles. But those intangibles would have been nothing without him having this vision and this belief, this deep-rooted belief, no matter what the obstacles were, in himself and his ability to reach his dreams.
Yeah, that's powerful, man. That's powerful. Because, yeah, you got to want it, then you got to put the work in to get to that point. You know, I want to ask you, before we transition into Power Moves, Inc., your company, I had a question about a couple of artists, man. Like, I know you were back there, obviously, with Big. You were around with Mace, Faith Evans, you was with Black Rob.
I broke Black Rob.
You broke Black Rob? All right, that's what's up.
Yeah, you asked Black Rob who broke him. I mean, the record label did their part, but me and Black Rob, we lived on the road together. Like, it was me and him, and he'd tell you that.
Man. And my man, yeah, whatever happened to Craig Mack, man? Brand New Flavor in Your Ear. That was my cut, man.
Yeah, I mean, Craig Mack is crazy. I guess that's a story you got to ask for Puff. I don't know whatever happened with because Craig Mack set the whole label off. He was, when Bad Boy was introduced, it was introduced with Flavor in Your Ear.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I don't know if the business wasn't right. I don't know if Craig Mack wasn't happy. I couldn't even tell you.
I hear you. But yeah, that's what's up, man. So now it's funny, man. I got to ask you real quick, because I know you got a marketing or promotions company. I did some research on you, man, and I remember this thing, bro. The Big Mac thing that you was doing with Biggie and Craig Mack.
Yep.
Yo, just tell the BEB family a little bit about this. And this is what I'm talking about, thinking out of the box and marketing your business. And we're going to get more into that as we talk about your story. But tell the BEB family that may be too young to remember this, what you did with Biggie and Craig Mack.
Well, I want to correct you, because as much as I would love to take credit for that particular promotion, it wasn't mine.
Oh, it wasn't my promotion. But tell us about it.
Yeah. I'll tell you about it. And you know, again, working, and this is for anybody who has a startup, anybody who is trying to get their business off the ground and get recognized. That was the position we were in at Bad Boy. Puff had recently got fired from Arista Records. He was the hot kid in the industry. He was young. He was brass. He was behind artists like Mary J. Blige and Jodeci. So he was coming in, you know, with the hot hand. And people were really looking like, okay, well, what's next? You were good when you was up under Andre Harrell.
Right.
You know, but what can you do now that you're on your own? And it's one thing to launch your label with artists, and I'm not even sure if your audience are going to remember the Craig Macks of the world, and obviously they'll remember Notorious B.I.G., because those were the first two artists that launched with Bad Boy Records. But we needed to come out of the box with something that was different, something that was going to set us apart. And I don't even remember, I don't know if it was Puff himself or was somebody in the office. Now, granted, I'm an intern at this point, so I'm the lowest guy on the totem pole. I'm street team at this point. They don't even acknowledge me. I don't get invited into the big meetings, so I can't take credit. But somebody in the office came up with the idea, Notorious B.I.G., Big, Craig Mack, Mac, why don't we get the McDonald's Big Mac cartons and we're going to put the, at that time it was cassettes. It wasn't even CDs. Right. We're going to actually put a cassette with Craig Mack's first single on side A and Biggie's first single on side B. And we're going to mail it out to all of the industry influencers, all of the DJs across the country, all of the writers, all of the people who are on the front line and the gatekeepers of breaking artists. And this is the way that we're going to introduce the world to not just the new Bad Boy Records, but to our new artists. And it was called the Big Mac campaign and killed them right out the gate. Everybody had to take notice. Something that was extremely inexpensive, but it was creative and it just was a play on words. So again, if you're an entrepreneur and you're getting into, I don't care if you if it's a bodega or a cleaners or your storefront brick and mortar business, find a way to separate yourself from the competition, and it doesn't always cost a lot of money. Sometimes it's just being creative and going back to grassroots tactics and doing something that's going to make you stand out from the competition.
Yeah, that was that. Whoever thought of that, that was genius, man.
Yeah,
that was no joke. That was genius, man. Question for you, man. We want to transition now into Power Moves Inc. Right. So tell us how and why you decided to move on. Did you move on from Bad Boy to your own thing, or did you have a step in between, or what?
Nah, to answer your question, I moved on from Bad Boy to my own thing.
Okay.
Now, I'll go back to my earlier story. I always wanted to be an entrepreneur, knew that, just didn't know what I wanted to do. So when I was doing parties, it was my first introduction to being an entrepreneur, and then I got this love affair with the music industry. Get the Bad Boy, I'm climbing through the ranks, my name is ringing, I can't go nowhere, whether it is in New York, across the country, or out of state, and you didn't say that Shawn Prez name, and it just didn't ring bells. And I'm not just saying that because I'm a humble guy, but it just was what it was. I was attached to the hottest label on the planet at that time.
Right.
But God has a calling for us. And no matter how big I was becoming in the music industry, that wasn't my ultimate destiny. And even when I didn't know it, it was always this thing in the back of my head talking like, Sean, you know, it's time for you to leave. It's time for you to leave. And while I was at Bad Boy, and you know, I mentioned that I was on the street team, then I started to run the street team, and I was literally coming up with these incredible marketing campaigns for our artists. Like every time a new artist would come out, I was charged, me and my department was charged with coming up with these creative marketing campaigns that was going to infiltrate the communities and really get people talking about these artists and playing the records and ultimately getting them into the stores to break to buy the records. And what I noticed in real time, even when I had a full-time job at Bad Boy, other companies were noticing my work. Corporate companies were noticing my work. And I was starting to get these independent accounts on the side. And, you know, I'm just thinking I was promoting records at that time.
Right.
But what I learned was my skill set was transferable. Records are records. But I had the ability to market, promote, infiltrate the urban communities in a way that big corporations just couldn't. And I started to get all of these checks from, you know, corporations at that point that didn't normally use the tactics that we use to break records. Mm-hmm. And I decided, you know, and I was scared. And here's the crazy thing, Jay, because there's somebody out there who's probably going through the same thing that I went through. It came to a point where I was making more money on the side than I was making in my salary.
Damn.
I was still scared to leave. I was still scared to put in my resignation. And, You know, it got to the point where I was literally, I was miserable, and I'm a kind of person, I'm very in tune to my inner voice. I'm very in tune to God. And God, you know, when he speaks, even if I shrug it off, I you know, God just, he pounds on me. He's like, wake up, Shawn, I'm talking and you're going to listen. Right. And finally I went and I put in my resignation, and I was scared to death to step out on my own, but I knew it was the right move.
Right, right. And
to answer your question, it's very specific because I have a unique case. When I put in my resignation, I gave them 2 weeks, or maybe I gave them even 3 weeks. Never heard from Puff.
Wow.
2 days before I was about to leave the company for good, I get a call from HR. Come, Puff want to see you. I'm like, damn. Like this is the call I didn't want to get. Puff called me into his office. And again, man, I tell this story, but people need to hear it, because sometimes you need to just do what you know you're supposed to do and then let God go to work and show you who he is.
Right.
I go into the office and I expect Puff to hit me with the guilt trip and, you know, I made you, and how you gonna leave me high and dry and this, that, and the third. And the complete opposite happened. He told me, he said, listen, I can't convince you to stay.
Right.
But I value you. You have been loyal. You have been a brother. So I want to make you a deal. If you truly want to become an entrepreneur and have your own business, I'll take you off payroll. I'm going to cut your health insurance. But why don't you stay exactly where you're at? I'll give you office space. I'll give you infrastructure. You can keep the phone lines. You can run your business out of Bad Boy.
Wow.
And let me be your first client. You tell me that ain't God. You tell me that ain't God showing us that I can dream a bigger dream than you. And from there, it was off to the races.
That's what's up, man. See, that's beautiful. And it's something that goes to show the mindset that Puff has, because before we started recording, we were sometimes talking about crabs in the barrel, but just that mindset. You never, when I had my mortgage business, I had over 50 plus employees, multi-million-dollar business, and I must have helped 3 or 4 people start their own mortgage business, because my thought process was that I will never hold a man or woman back that thinks they can do something better to take care of their family. So that's, I'm right, not going to fight that. I'm going to support that, because I'm confident in myself that there's enough business. You can have 50 mortgage brokers in my building. It doesn't matter. I'm confident that I'm going to be successful. So with Diddy just having that mindset where he's not kicking you out, he's like, look, I respect what you did. I appreciate what you did. I love it so much. Yo, can I be your first client? You know what I'm saying? So you don't get that from a lot of bosses out there, especially somebody on that level, you know, like Diddy. So I know, unfortunately, there are a lot of negative stories out there about him, but I'm glad that you brought that out, man. So you can give people a peek behind the curtain to see that, yo, this brother's a serious brother, man. He's not playing around, and he supports the people that obviously support him. So thank you so much, man, for sharing that.
Yeah, I think there's so many people out there who thrive off negativity, and you know, you hear all of these stories about a side of Puff that, you know, I personally haven't seen. I can tell you my experience. That right. Man is a big reason that my area code and my zip code changed. Mm-hmm. Like I can attribute so much of my success and my bank account changed. I can trip. And one thing I just want to interject and just say right here, mm-hmm. None of this would have happened if I didn't put in the work. So yes, Puff is great. He changed my life. I have nothing but good things to say about him. And the things that I might not be so great about him, I wouldn't say him publicly anyway, because, you know, you can fight with your brothers all day long, but when you go out, you love your brothers, right? But the truth of the matter is, I put in the work and I brought value to his situation. And for any of you out there who are aspiring to do something and set out on your own, you don't know where your blessing's gonna come from, but you gotta put in the work and you gotta bring value to any situation that you're in. So don't think that my situation was just he gave me a handout or a hand up in that case. He recognized that my skill set and my loyalty and my ability to move the needle was something he needed to keep close. Mm-hmm. And that's something that I want everybody to remember, no matter what it is that you're doing.
That's what's up. Now, that's an excellent point. Thank you for interjecting that, man. So you were making more money on your side business than you were working with Bad Boy. So the Power Moves, Inc., tell us about what Power Moves, Inc. is and what you actually do. And before I go there, let me just, I want you to explain, because some of the younger BEB family members might not understand what a street team is. Mm-hmm. Can you just tell them what a street team is real quick, and then we'll transition?
Okay, so I'll take you back. Street teams, when we started working at Bad Boy, we didn't have big budgets. So the kind of money that rolled into the music industry in the mid to late 90s and early 2000s was astronomical. Mm-hmm. But rap music wasn't even supposed to make it. If, you know, Jay, you're old enough to remember, just like I am, rap music was the little engine that could. And yep. We didn't get big budgets back then. All those huge marketing budgets that the country artists got and the rock artists got, rappers did not get those budgets. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm saying that to say we had to find creative, resourceful ways to market and promote our artists. And if you can't have, if you don't have the budgets for big billboards and TV spots and radio spots, you have to think outside of the box. How can I infiltrate the community? How can I get my product heard and adopted, you know, in Flint, Michigan, as well as in, you know, the South Bronx? So we created these street teams, which are, I guess in today's world, if you go online and social media, it's a bunch of influencers. They carry a lot of weight with their audiences. That's what street teams are. In their communities, we went and we cherry picked who was the coolest kid in his high school. Who was that girl who was always ahead of the curve in terms of fashion? She knew what was going to be next. Everybody looked to her because she was the one who was going to tell you where the fashion curve was going to turn. Who was that person who was just the funniest person on the block, or, you know, he or she was the most popular person in their circle? And we would look for these people, we would recruit them, and we would teach them how to now become marketers and use their influence for a specific reason in their region. So we had street teams all over the countries, top 10 markets, Chicago, Detroit, Philly, mm-hmm. LA, so forth and so on. And, you know, and then we had our secondary and tertiary markets. And we would literally, these would be our eyes, they would be our ears, they would be the people who we would go to, who would be our litmus testers, who we would say, well, we're thinking about putting this record out. You know, tell me what the DJs in the clubs, how do they react to this record? And they would come back and be like, this is going to be a hit. Or I done, you know, tested this out with 10 different radio programmers and DJs, and they say it's a dud. Save your money. Go to something else.
Right.
It is the same thing with, you know, so when I created Power Moves, Inc. Marketing and Promotion, it was just an extension of what I was doing at Bad Boy already. Okay. I had these street teams already in place around the country. I created them. They work for me on a daily basis. And now, instead of promoting and marketing records, we were promoting and marketing products. And what made us special and what continues to make us special, and you've worked in corporate America for many years of your career, Jay. Mm-hmm. Corporate, they tend to have people in place. Just because somebody has a big title don't mean that they know what the hell that they're doing. like right. You know, I'm an African American man, mm-hmm. right? I'm from the South Bronx. I hang out with people who look like me, talk like me. I understand the lingo. I understand our vernacular. So when I would go into these corporate meetings and I'm telling them, look, this is the way you should be marketing and promoting your products to resonate with our people, whether it is black or brown people, Hispanics, so forth and so on, they would look at me like I got 10 heads. But for the companies that said, you know what, we might not understand your tactics. They are not traditional in the sense of the way we market, but we're going to give you a shot. We, in every case, was able, this is the way the company grew. If we was able, in every case, to show them with a smaller budget, we can infiltrate these neighborhoods and these individuals in a way that if you put three times the money running TV ads, you will never ever infiltrate these neighborhoods because you don't present it and package it the way that we will. And we came across with so much authenticity and credibility. Now, when we were coming to the neighborhood with these products, people were like, I will give it a try, a fair shot, because it was introduced to me by somebody I know, I trust, and I respect.
Right. That's what's up. So, man, that's powerful, man, because a lot of times we always think that we have to have a lot of money as entrepreneurs. We got to spend all of this budget on Facebook ads, Instagram, you know, influencers and stuff like that. So basically you're talking about more guerrilla marketing tactics and able to infiltrate and penetrate the market space that the corporate guys didn't know how to do. Let me ask you this, man, in terms of financing, we know that Diddy allowed you to work in that office, but for the current entrepreneurs listening, even prospective entrepreneurs, man, how did you finance your business, Power Moves, Inc.?
Great question. And, you know, to go back what you said earlier, yes, at the core of it, Power Moves, Inc. is a guerrilla marketing, grassroots, alternative marketing agency. That's who and what we are, whether that is social, digital, or on the ground. Mm-hmm. We financed in... At that time, I wasn't getting no bank loan, right? I couldn't walk into no bank and say, hey, I'm trying to start a business. I need a small business loan. It didn't work like that.
Unless you had a mask on, right?
Exactly. So number one, I was used to working on a shoestring budget, just to be totally honest with you. And I think that a mistake that so many companies make is they want to appear bigger than they are. So they go out and they hire people and they get these big offices and they invest in things that on the outside, it makes them look like they're popping, but they're really not. And you know, out the gate, they're struggling and they got this noose around their neck because they're drowning in debt. Hmm. We didn't do that. So like I told you, before I even left the company, before I even got off payroll, I had a couple of clients already.
Right.
And that is the money that I, and then obviously Bad Boy became a client of mine. And that is the money that I used to seed my company, hire my first couple of people. And in my case, I didn't have to worry about office space, phone lines, internet, because it was given to me through Puff allowing me to use his infrastructure. But it was real, and here's something that I think your audience has to hear. And I say this, and I'm going to continue to say this. Okay. Every interview I do, there are more than 8 hours in the day. Get over yourself. You say you want it. How bad do you want it? Because that 9 to 5 you're working, the minute that you decide you want to become an entrepreneur, that 9 to 5, you better look at as your side hustle. And when you get off at 5, from 5 to 1, 5 to 2 in the morning, that becomes your job. And you start to build your business while working at a business. Let your 9 to 5 pay for your life and fund you. You might not have my level of blessings where where Puff was, you know, basically knew what I was doing and he got behind me. So mm-hmm. what if, you know, let's say I worked at a regular 9 to 5. When I got off at 5, I would go to work and work 5 to 2 in the morning. And soon as I got that up running, income starting to come in, then I can finally leave. So I'm tired of people, and I don't want you to give yourself a way out by saying, okay, Shawn, you were blessed. No, I was putting in the work, and you can too. There are more than 8 hours in the day. Use them. Those 8 hours that you do 9 to 5, that's now should be your side hustle. But when you get off of that mm-hmm. job that's paying your bills, you need to go to work for yourself and build up your client base. Build up yourself to where you're bringing in income. And when you find that, hey, I am now making as much money as I'm making on that job that's paying me week over week, that's when you leave.
Yeah, that's powerful, man. I want the BEB family to take note of that. That's I like the way you put it. That 9 to 5 is your side hustle. Anything after that, that's your real business. And it's funny, man, because I do a lot of coaching. Mm-hmm. And one of the things is a lot of newer entrepreneurs, they don't understand what you have to put into it to be successful. Because now I think in today's society, we have, you know, instant gratification everywhere. You got instant rice. You put it in the microwave for a minute. Now you got jasmine rice, and you know what I mean? You got instant everything. And so I think that a lot of times the recognition of what it takes to be successful now may be missed by a lot of people because, oh man, everybody got commitments. If you got kids, you got commitments. You got a spouse, you got commitments. You got a full-time day job, whatever, you got commitments. The question is, how are you going to leverage? And I like what you talked about. Basically, you're talking about leveraging your day job to build your real business. And there, so leveraging,
but it's a mind shift, Jay. It's a mind shift. And that's what I want people to get. The minute you are committed to whatever your dream is, whatever your idea, whatever that business that you one day want to see flourish, switch your mindset. That is now your job. That is now your purpose. And whatever it is that is your 9 to 5 that you punching in, punching out, that's your side hustle.
That's it. That's powerful, bro. Because, yeah, you got to think like that to make it happen, man. I just talked about leverage real quick, man. And I want to rock and move real quick to the Global Spin Awards. So I always tell people that I coach, if you're working for somebody else or whatever, leverage the resources, leverage the technology, leverage. And so leverage your contacts. And the Global Spin Awards, tell us about how that started and how you leverage your industry contacts to get that off the ground.
Okay, so first and foremost, for anybody who has never heard of the Global Spin Awards, essentially it is the Grammys for the DJs. It is the highest honor that any DJ can receive in a calendar year. So it is red carpet, black tie. Think of the Grammys, but instead of giving artists award, the DJs are now recognized and they get a Global Spin Award. So let's start there.
Okay.
But in terms of leveraging, you know, Jay, you just hit the nail on the head, right? Another way to put it is innovation. You mm-hmm. think about, how can I use my resources that I currently have in stock that I am using and working with every day, but how can I innovate? How can I leverage this into something new and create a new revenue stream? And me working so many years in the music industry, it was my job to work with DJs day in and day out. They were the people who literally all day, every day, I was picking up the phone. What do you think about this record? Yo, I need you to play this record over the weekend. I know you got 3-4 mix shows going on. I need this record playing in every one of your mix shows. So forth and so on. If you're in this many clubs during the week, I need this record playing in every one of your sets. And then I need the feedback. Is the crowd feeling it? So forth and so on. So the DJs are a big part of my success.
Okay.
And for me, I started to get to a point in my career, I'm pretty successful, I'm making great money, I wanted to give back. And mm-hmm. the DJs had given me so much and they had helped position me over the years. I looked and I was like, you know what? If you are an artist, you have the Grammys, American Music Awards, so forth and so on. If you're an actor, you have the Oscars, you got the Golden Globes, so forth and so on. If you're a writer, you got the BMI, the ASCAP Awards, so forth and so on. But the people who are on the front line of breaking records every day, 365 days a year, they had no formal entity set up to recognize them and their contributions to breaking records. And it was crazy because I would see these artists who would beg DJs to play my record. I need you to support me. Yo, right now my last record didn't do good. I just need you to get on this record because I'm trying to, you know, to get right back on top. Those artists, those same artists, not to say it was anything bad, but those same artists would go to the Grammys, receive an award, thank everybody and their mother except for the DJs. Mm-hmm. And I said to myself, you know what? I have great relationships with DJs, not just locally, but around the world. Why don't I create, which we now know as the Global Spin Awards, to recognize these unsung heroes? And for me, it was just a transitioning, if you will. It was just a leveraging, to use your word, of I deal with these DJs every day of the week. Mm-hmm. Why don't I do something now and I can still call on them, which I'm going to do anyway, and have them take part in me building this new business, which is the Global Spin Awards. And the DJs, they adopted it and really got behind it and made it the number one show for DJs on the planet.
That's what's up, man. See, that's that's leveraging this innovation. Let me ask you though, man, when you first started the awards, was it smooth? Did everybody buy
it? Hell no. Hell no. I don't know what the rest of your question is, but I'm going to answer the first part of it. Hell, and sorry, I'm trying to keep it PG here.
No, that's all right. I knew that was the answer. And the reason I'm asking you that is because even with all of your contacts, your leverage, your experience in the industry, you still had to be consistent to get the awards to where they are. Can you speak to that consistency and what it took to turn the Global Spin Awards into what it is now versus when it first started? Basically, the maturation of that process.
Okay, great. I want to highlight something to your audience, right? Listen to what Jay just said. I'm Shawn Prez in the industry. I got relationships with all of these DJs. I go and segue and create this Global Spin Awards for the DJs. So you should think that this is going to be a very easy process. But when you're an entrepreneur, you can never, ever, ever take for granted or sit on your laurels or think that what you did yesterday is going to make it smooth and easy sailing for what you plan to do tomorrow. The road to success is always under construction. I can tell you that. There's going to be bumps in the road. There's going to be detours, potholes, and everything else. So be real clear about that. So for us, before I started the awards, we talked about vision earlier. I had this huge vision for what I wanted the awards to be, but I didn't have the experience. When I started the awards, I didn't have live production experience. I wanted it to be the Grammys in the first year, but there's right. So many things with the Grammys is 100 years old or something like that. It took that many years for them to become what they have become. So number one, I shot too big too early, and I tried to do this massive production, and I just didn't have the experience, and I didn't hire the right people. But there was something else. The DJs, although they loved the idea, they were skeptical. And nobody wants to lose publicly.
Right.
So we you know, put this out there for the DJs, but a lot of DJs were like, well, who's voting? How do we know it's not rigged? Who's to say this DJ is more accomplished in this particular area than I am? So I started to get that type of pushback, and I'm like, well, damn, I'm doing this for y'all. Like, support it. DJs were like, nah, I don't want to support this right off. I mean, some did, some stepped up, but a lot of them were just like, no, like, I can't get behind this because, you know, I don't know that this ain't rigged and you just ain't going to give somebody an award because you want them to play your record the day after. So for me, I was dealing with all of this internal politics that I didn't see coming, in addition to the fact that I was underfunded, and I had this huge vision, but I wasn't prepared for what it took to get to that point. And just to be quite honest, the first year was a disaster.
Right.
But again, for anybody who's listening to this, and trust me when I tell you, I pride myself on working hard. I pride myself. If I'm going to do something, I'm going to put my heart into it. Like, I'm there. I'm going all the way with it. But it was a disaster, and I could have quit. And right. I wanted to hide my face, and I wanted to put my head under a rock. And basically, don't call me. Like, I'm embarrassed. I'm ashamed. My name is on this. And it just turned out to be a disaster.
Oh.
But then, you know, our first Global Spin Award, Sway, from Sway's Universe on Sirius and MTV and all of the legendary stuff that he's done, he was our host. And I remember he pulled me to the side and he said, Sean, this is bad. He was like, in real time, the guy's hosting the show. I'm going crazy. I want to throw stuff because nothing's going right. We got presenters coming to the stage. They don't know what they're presenting. They're talking about certain categories, and they're like, you know, DJ of the year, DJ Khaled, and up on the screen, the Frontmaster Flex face comes up. It was just a nightmare. It was like, my God, anything that could go wrong is going wrong. But Sway pulled me to the side and he said, Sean, this is bad. And I'm not going to sugarcoat it, but I've seen worse. You got to keep it together because you got something here. He was like, I'm telling you, this is terrible. I'm not even going to make you feel better, but you got something here. And people like Red Alert, who I admired and respected for so many years, was coming up to me and telling me, you got something, you got to keep it going. And those were the seeds that I needed to keep it going because I was ready to pack it in. So for any of you guys who, you know, you when you start your business, it's not going to come out perfect. You know, you're going to lose a client or two. Things are going to go wrong. You're going to send out an email address to somebody else and it's going to go to the wrong person. Like, things are going to happen, but stick with it. Stick with it, because if it is a good idea, if it's a good investment, if you believe that it's good, yes, take feedback from people, learn from your mistakes. But if you thought enough of it to get into it, 9 out of 10 is worth pursuing. So don't give up on yourself so early.
Yeah, that's something, man. So my man Sway was like, yo, this is horrible. Huh?
Nah, he told me the truth. Like, he told me in real time, like, because in between him going and hosting on stage, we would be back. And you know, I'm back there ready to throw chairs. And he looked at me kind of like, you know, the slap on the face. Get it together, Sean. Like, this is your show. Get it together. And it is terrible, but I've seen worse. You got something here. And coming from somebody I respected, you know, I had to take that, you know, to the bank. And when I got over myself, two, 3 weeks later, I was ready to show my face in public again. I was like, all right, like I just got to make it better next year.
Man, it's funny. I was going to ask you to tell us a time when you had a setback in your business or something failed and stuff like that. But we're gonna use that answer for that.
yeah, no, no, that, that was first, But here's the deal, Jay, and this is why, like these conversations in your platform is so needed, especially for all people, because you only look at people when you see the successes. You see right. the times that they hit it and it went out the park. You don't see all the misses. You don't see all the foul balls. You don't see all the strikeouts. You don't see all the time that they putting in the gym. You don't see none of that. You just focus on, oh, man, this person just came up the bat and they hit it out. They're successful. No, there are so many setbacks, and it's so many times that you know, you are in debt, and you are about to lose it all, and you're questioning because nothing's going right, and you think that, you know, maybe I should go back and play it safe and get a job, and at least I know every other week I got a check coming and it's guaranteed, and I got health care. But if you got, number one, you got to be built for this. Like, this entrepreneurship, exactly. this is real. Like, this is it. Now, the payoff is big. The you know, it's great to say I'm a boss, but there's a lot of commitment that goes with this thing. And there's going to be a lot of setbacks before you see your success. But you got to stick it out.
Got it. Yeah, because it's funny, like, in my backstory, man, and I'm transparent on the podcast, I almost lost it all twice. You know, the last time, my mortgage business, man, multi-million-dollar mortgage business. I ain't never sold drugs in my life, but that cake was like drug cake right there. And so 2008, that thing went off the cliff, almost lost everything. I mean, so then I had to kind of like you, man, you had, and I want to talk to you about this in terms of like passion and stuff. So I kind of had to not rebrand myself, but come back and make sure I'm doing what my assignment is. Mm-hmm. So a lot of times, you know, I got a new book coming out called Pinpoint and Monetize Your Genius, right? And so your genius is the intersection between your passion and your talent. And so when I came back after my mortgage business collapsed, I was like, yo, I got to come back in my genius space. Now, I didn't know I was formulating this book while I was going through this process, but what do I like to do? What don't I like to do? What am I passionate about? What are certain things that I cannot give up, like family time, you know, stuff like that I spend with my family. And so I just think that when you align yourself with something that you're passionate, you know, with, and you have a proficiency for whatever, you know, you're doing, just like you have, you love, you know, the music, you love the industry, you love your marketing, you're a marketer. That's what you are. You're a marketer.
That's who I am.
Yeah, right. You're a marketer. And so when you align all of that together, the result is Power Moves, Inc. You see what I mean? So my result is Black Entrepreneur Blueprint, all my businesses, my e-commerce, my platforms, my online courses, all of that stuff, my books, all of that stuff. So when you can align yourself like that, I think that gives people the best chance for success. And I always say the highest form of entrepreneurship is being able to monetize your genius. You know what I mean? Because a lot of people chase that. Oh, thank you, brother. A lot of people chase the money. And so, yeah, I was doing that at first. And one, you know, some of my businesses, oh man, I can make good money in here. Because I'm a serial entrepreneur and I actually enjoy building things. So it could be a mortgage business. It could be, you know, whatever. But I like building. But then I said, all right, well, let me start building stuff that I'm passionate about and do things that I'm good at. So I tell people when I do my speeches and talks, they ask me to give, you know, three pieces of information or three suggestions or recommendations. And mine are always do what you love, do what you're good at, and do what somebody will pay you for. And if you can align those three things, you ain't gonna never work a day in your life, bro. You see what I'm saying? And that's what it's about, man. So
that's great stuff right there, Jay. That's great stuff you just said.
Thank you, brother. Thank you, brother. 303 episodes now on the podcast. So I got all that free game for y'all. All right. Make sure y'all tune in. So, man, let me ask you real quick, man. As a professional marketer, and what people have to understand too is that entrepreneurship is a profession. So you kind of hit on it. You can't play around with this thing. This is a profession. If you don't treat it like a profession, you're not going to get out of it what you can get out of it. I want to ask you, man, as a marketer, how do today's entrepreneurs cut through all of the noise? Because we got so many things coming at us, social media, TV, radio, podcasts are jumping right now. How do you cut through all of that, man, to get your message out to your prospective customers?
I think that's a great question. And it really depends on the business you're in. But here's where it starts. I always start in the truth. What is the nucleus of the atom? Meaning, let's say, for instance, and I told this story before and I'll tell it to your audience. Before Puff ever launched Ciroc, when he just did the deal with Diageo, you know, him being Puff, he's in his Miami home at that time and he's stressed, but he understood the upside of what Ciroc vodka could be. And he called me, it's 5 a.m, and he's like, Sean, his exact words, I need you to put that brilliant marketing brain to work because this Ciroc thing is big and it can change all of our lives. And I told him, I said, let me think about it. Let me just sit and think and go with my staff and get in the war room. And I had to come at this thing the way that I come at everything. I had to be very authentic to the product. I had to be very truthful to what the product was and understand who our consumer base was. And again, it hit me like a ton of bricks. Your word, leveraging, right? So before people ever knew even how to pronounce Ciroc, think about the way it's spelled, C-I-R-O-C. Phonetically, it's Ciroc. You don't know how to pronounce that. Like, exactly. So we were tasked with something that was, you know, it seemed like a uphill battle for us out the gate because phonetically, you couldn't look at it and pronounce it. And then traditionally, our people drink brown liquor. Like we love our browns. We love, you know, Henny. We yep. love that dark, right? So for me, after sitting with it, I came up with this brilliant idea. And I was like, yo, the DJs. I was like, that's the answer.
DJs.
Ask me why. Why the DJs? On the surface, it doesn't look like nothing. But let's think about the DJs. How do they make their money? They're spinning in a club. 4, 5, 6 nights a week. Who's in the club? People who are partying, having a good time. And what do you do when you party and have a good time? You drink.
That's so
I was like, let me put together a collection of the best DJs in the country. Mm-hmm. Khaled, Funk Flex, DJ Envy, DJ Drama, the biggest DJs in the country, SNS. So I literally put together this all-star team. Mm. This all-star team of DJs over every region of this country. And we gave them a cool name, the Ciroc Boys, Ciroc Boy DJ Crew. And we told them, go out and I want you to push this liquor onto your constituents. Because each of the DJs brought something to the table that we didn't have. They had right. their own audience. Drama had a very different audience than Khaled at that time. Khaled right. had a very different audience than Envy at that time. So forth and so on. And when they hit it, and when they were in the clubs, and they were telling people, Grey Goose is dead. Y'all got to get up on the Ciroc. Now come to the DJ booth. I got drink tickets for you. And, you know, I'm going to buy that table over there. I'm going to send y'all a bottle and all of the sparklers come out and all of that stuff. And then they would go on the radio the next day and they would start talking and they was giving the shout outs and they would shout out to the Ciroc boys and shout out to my Ciroc girls who was in the club last night. We had a crazy time and everybody was getting lit off Ciroc. It was very authentic. It was very credible. It was able to separate us from what Grey Goose was doing, Kettle One was doing, Amsterdam, and all of these other vodkas. But we gave it a cool factor. And exactly. that was the spark that got people talking about, what is this? Diddy's pushing this new thing. Is Ciroc okay, let me give it a try. And then when they gave it a try, it just was good.
Yeah.
The rest is history.
Man, let me ask you, did you have to compensate the Ciroc boys for yes, pushing
them? Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay. Gotcha. Gotcha.
And you know, here's the deal. I'm a person with deep relationships. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you want to call in your favors, but you want to pay people, even if you can't pay them their worth, you want to show them I value what you bring to the table. I want you committed to what it is that I'm doing. So sometimes we think that we have to go out and we got to pay these astronomical rates. And it doesn't always work like that. Sometimes you just look a person in the eye and let them know, this is what I'm trying to do. I know I can't cut you a check that'll change your life, because the checks I was cutting those guys wasn't changing their life. But they understood what we were working for was bigger. And they also knew Puff had been such a supporter of their careers for so many years. Shawn Prez had been such a supporter of their careers for so many years. Let's get together and do something that could be bigger than all of us.
That's what's up. Now, that's something the BEB family light bulb, another light bulb going off. That's powerful, man. One of the things I talked about on one of my episodes was the power of reciprocity, right? So value. People don't buy things until they see, quote unquote, the value, right? So when you pour into somebody else with what you've been doing throughout your whole career, it's natural. The law of reciprocity says, if this brother or sister is pouring into me, then I need to pour into him or her. And it doesn't necessarily have to be money, but like you say, showing the appreciation, the respect, you know, for what they've been doing, or, you know, and what you've done for them. And that's why I always tell people, I'm like, look, you don't have to buy my online course. You know, if one of my courses isn't for you, everybody's at a different stage. But you can do something positive, leave me a 5-star review on iTunes, you know what I mean? iTunes for the podcast. So I always tell people, a lot of times when you're doing a joint venture or you're doing some type of partnership thing, is there has to be value coming from both sides. And appreciate BEB family, what a brother like Shawn Prez has done out there, and reciprocate by checking out everything that he's doing. And before we close out, I know you got a new YouTube channel that you start. So before we close on out in a couple minutes, I'm going to let you give all that contact information so the BEB family can connect with you. But we got to start reciprocating, and the information and the knowledge that this brother has poured into the BEB family today, you know how we do. We got to show them love. So I want to say, man, before I forget, because we rapping like, you know, like crazy. But I want to say before I forget, man, that I just appreciate the stories, the wisdom that comes from know-how being doing, that you've imparted to the Black Entrepreneur Blueprint family, man, because you've been dropping jewels on us all day, man. Yeah, brother. But that's the type of thing that we need. We need people with your type of experiences to go and share that, hey, it's not going to be always roses and, you know, everything is fine. There's bumps in the road, like you said, detours and things that we have to fight through. But if you're a true entrepreneur, if you truly believe in what you're doing, if you have a mission, something that's greater than the money, you know, money is great. And I tell people, once you get to a certain level when your dollars are good, everything is paid, you're not worrying about your lights getting cut off, you know, your cars are paid, your house is paid for, the mindset shifts a little bit. And it's more to, okay, I'm good. How can I be of service to others? And a lot of times we're so wrapped up in trying to make it and get there that sometimes we don't appreciate what others have done for us and wisdom that they've imparted, you know, to us and the BEB family. So please, whatever my brother is doing, support my brother. You see what he's done in the industry, the type of man that he is, and the things that he's brought to our community. So reciprocate, family. So matter of fact, Shawn, give us your contact information right now, so how the BEB family can connect with you and support what you're doing, man.
Jay, thanks for setting that up. That's like the perfect layup, man.
So my man.
Thank you so much for setting that up for me. But truth be told, guys, for one, thank you all for if you've stayed to this part of the interview, hopefully I was able to share something with you that will make a difference in your journey. Jay, thanks for having me. I really love and appreciate your platform. I can be reached across all platforms at Power, P-O-W-E-R, Moves, M-O-V-E-S, with an S, Prez, my last name, P as in Paul, R as in Roger, E as in Elvis, Z as in Zebra, at Power Moves Prez. But more specific, if you guys can support my new YouTube channel, my mission in life, my purpose, what I'm doing is the same thing that Jay is doing. I love to dialogue with, provide insight into the minds of successful people who look like us, who come from the same place that we come from, because truth be told, my story, I'm just a kid from the South Bronx, period. And if I can do it, I know you can do it. So please, look for me on YouTube again, Power Moves Prez, and I have great interviews with a lot of entrepreneurs who come from the same places that you come from and who have done extraordinary things in their lives, and they are willing to provide you with insight into their mindset, how what it took for them to get from where they started to now where they've gone in their life. So thank you so much, Jay.
Nah, I appreciate you, man. Is there anything that you want to say that I may have left out during our conversation that you want to impart? Did I miss anything?
No, I think you covered everything. And you know, I just wanted to bring home, and that's why I took the long way to answer that last question that you just asked. This is not rocket science. Like, you can be successful. I don't care who you are. You can be successful. How big is your vision? Are you living your purpose? Are you working with your gifts? And are you willing to put in the work? Because if you are, the money comes. The money will come. Notice everything that I've said during this entire interview, and Jay, you have been hammering on it. Don't do it for the money. I've never done one thing in this life, and I promise you on everything, I've never done one thing in this life for a paycheck.
That's what's up.
The money just seems to come.
That's it. That's what the focus is, man. Last question for you, brother. I always close out with this. If you had an opportunity to have a conversation with one person, living or dead, who would it be and why?
Well, I got a chance to meet this person, but we didn't get a chance to conversate. Muhammad Ali, my all-time idol. I was going to say between him and Nelson Mandela, but my heart is just always with Muhammad Ali. I love everything that he stood for. I love the fact that, again, it goes to what we have been talking about. He was willing to forego money, titles, world championships for what he believed. And that's what was most important to him. And because of that, he transcended boxing. He transcended the world of sports. And he became this global icon of what you can become, even in the worst oppositions, you know, because at the height of his career, he decided to stand up for what he believed, and they stripped him of everything. And he came back that much stronger.
Yeah. That's what's up, man. I got an opportunity. It was Tyson's last fight in D.C. I forgot the cat he was fighting when he quit in like the second or third round. And Layla Ali was on the undercard. So I was on the floor. So when Ali came out before Layla was fighting, I got a chance to shake his hand. But once again, I obviously couldn't talk to him and stuff like that. But that was always one of the people that I would have loved to sit down and talk to also, man.
Want to hear a quick story? I had the opportunity to sit with Muhammad and watch The Thriller in Manila with him.
Wow.
How big is that?
Damn. How'd that come off, man? I watched the old video
of himself in The Thriller in Manila, and I got an opportunity to watch it with him.
That's amazing, man. How did that come about, man?
You know, him and Puff were friends, and we were out in Phoenix, Arizona, and Puff, you know, he was kind of like a godfather to him. And while we were in Phoenix, Arizona, Puff decided, like, let me go and just check in with him. And I went with him. And, you know, at that time, his health was kind of declining. Still very, very aware up here. His motor skills just weren't the best. And he was literally, Layla Ali was home with her family. Like, literally, we were in their house, in their living room, spent a couple of hours just sitting there reminiscing. And, you know, I was able to get some cool pictures with him. So that was one for my of the things I got to cross off my bucket list.
Bucket list, yeah, man, that's great stuff, man. Yeah, I'm sure you got a whole bunch of them stories, but but brother, once again, I want to thank you so much, man, for sharing your wisdom and your experience with the Black Entrepreneur Blueprint family, man. Anytime you got anything happening, just hit me up, and we're gonna bring you back on, brother.
My brother, thank you so much.
Oh, my man. All right, brother.
Man, that was a dynamic interview with my man, Shawn Prez. He laid it down, and he gave us so many gems and jewels. And I just want to highlight a couple of things that he talked about, and one thing in particular. But before we get to that phase of the show, I just want to share all my social media contact information and my resource links with the BEB family. First and foremost, guys, you know my new book is out, A New Black Wall Street, Circulating the Black Dollar Worldwide by Building Successful E-Commerce Businesses. You can go to anewblackwallstreet.com, pick yourself up a copy, $14.95 for the printed version, $9.95 for the digital version. Also, I have a compatible new implementation program for anybody that's interested in building an e-commerce business, be it a physical products business or a digital business. And it's called BrandBuilderElite.com, BBAElite.com, a 12-week implementation program. Just go to BBAElite.com and you can register. I have a promo going on now. So when you go to register, go to BBAElite.com. And when you put in the information, put your coupon code BBAElite100. That takes an additional $100 off the program. Normally, it was selling for $397. It's only $97 now because of this coronavirus. So go to BBAElite.com. There's a short video you can listen to and learn all about the program. And then when you go in and ready to join, put in BBAElite100 and you'll save an extra $100. Also, I talked at the top of the show about two platforms that I've created to help circulate dollars in the Black community. The first one is BeSmartByBlack.com, BeSmartByBlack.com. So any Black product producer that wants to connect and sell their products to Black consumers worldwide, upload your product information. It is free to BeSmartByBlack.com. Now, I didn't forget about you freelancers. So if you do anything on Fiverr.com or Freelancer, if you are a Black freelancer, upload your information to hireblackfreelancers.com, H-I-R-E, blackfreelancers.com. Once again, it's free. And this way you can connect with Black consumers and Black business owners that want to hire Black freelancers. Now, in reference to me coming out to speak, this coronavirus is crazy right now. But when that breaks, you can just go to bookjjones.com, fill out the short form, and I'll get right back to you, bookjjones.com. Now, if you need to reach out to me for anything long, hit me on my email at jjones@blackentrepreneurblueprint.com, J-A-Y-J-O-N-E-S @blackentrepreneurblueprint.com, Facebook, Black Entrepreneur Blueprint, Twitter, jjones001, Instagram, jjones4real, the number 4, R-E-A-L, YouTube. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel. I have additional content on YouTube that is not on the show. Go to YouTube, type in Black Entrepreneur Blueprint, hit that subscribe button and the like button. LinkedIn, J. Jones, Black Entrepreneur Blueprint. Also, BEB text line. You can text BEB to 555-888. Text BEB to 555-888. All of this was a mouthful. So all you have to do, guys, is go to BEBconnect.com, BEBconnect.com,
And everything that I just mentioned, my resource links and also my contact information and social media information is there. BEBconnect.com. All right, now let's go and talk about some takeaways from today's show. Once again, we want to thank my man Shawn Prez again for spending time with the BEB family and dropping some gems for us, I'm telling you, and getting a little insight, you know, into the workings of Bad Boy and the way Diddy works. And the first thing I want to talk about is work ethic that he talked about. He mentioned that, you know, he was a hard worker, but when he saw the way Diddy was working, it brought his level up to another game. So if anybody's watching the Michael Jordan special, The Last Dance, you see how Mike was saying, look, this is the standard, and you got to keep up with this standard if you're going to be on this team with me. And so the way Diddy worked made everybody step their level up. And so when you do that, then your productivity is going to go up, and obviously your production is going to go up, all right? Next, he talked about there were more than 8 hours in a day. A lot of times as entrepreneurs, we put in, you know, we leave the 9 to 5, but then we work at our business and we still do the same hours, 9 to 5. There's more than 8 hours in the day, all right? And this is what I really like, what he said. He said, treat your 9 to 5, if you're trying to transition, treat your 9 to 5 like your side hustle. That's your side hustle. Your real business starts from 6 to whatever. That's your real business. So put that focus. Yeah, you gotta do your 9 to 5 and you gotta do what you gotta do to keep getting that paycheck. But mentally, change it around. Your 9 to 5 is your side hustle. Your business is your main business. And I really like when he said that because it's about a mind shift, being able to change your mind. And the last thing I wanted to highlight was what he said about Diddy. So when he went in to give his, when he was going to leave the business, when he was going to give his resignation, and Diddy called him in the office a couple of days before his last day, he was thinking he was going to get cussed out or whatever. But see, it was the opposite. What Diddy did was he recognized the talent that this man has. He recognized the benefit that Shawn could bring him and the Bad Boy, okay? And what he did was he said, nah, man, I'm not going to cuss you out. Yo, go ahead and set your office up over here, use these phone lines, blah, 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 and I'm going to help you, okay? And because I've seen your work, I know what you can do because you show improved, I'm going to be your first full-time client. So what that tells me is that what Shawn did when he was an intern all the way up to the day that he left, he put his best foot forward and he took no shorts. He had the work ethic. He had the mentality to be successful. And being successful is not just working hard, but it's having the right mentality. When Shawn talked about he went through like 6 internships and he finally popped on the last one with Bad Boy. Do you know the type of mental fortitude it takes to even go through 6 internships? And so when people say they want to be successful, the question is, how successful do you really want to be? How bad do you want to win? And that's going to make anybody, like I said, it's going to make you ask questions. Man, do I really want this? And it's going to weed itself out. So you could be on the top half of the people that really want it. They do whatever's necessary to be successful, or you could be on the bottom half and say, you know what, I quit. So there were so many takeaways from this interview, man. It was dynamic, and we appreciate Shawn spending time with the BEB family. And you know how we do, guys. Make sure, you know, you support Shawn. Go to his website, go to everything, check him out, see what he's doing, and support the brother. He's doing tremendous things for the community and in the community. And once again, that's how we roll here at Black Entrepreneur Blueprint. Now, make sure you guys check out BEBconnect.com. That has all of my resource links. I also have a link to the show here and Shawn's links to all of his stuff there. So go to BEBconnect.com and I'll see you guys same time next week. And I say it each and every week because I mean it. Guys, we get more and more downloads every episode. And that's because of you, the BEB family. Please continue to spread the word. We're trying to get this good word out there. It's an economic empowerment movement. It's not a podcast. It's not a show. It's a movement, you know, building up the black economy, all right? Working with each other, You know, starting businesses, supporting businesses. You know, there's no revolution without economics. I got the t-shirt. I created the t-shirt. Don't have it on today. But there's no revolution without economics. Everything starts from economics, family. And once you then have the economics, you can start controlling other facets of our lives to improve our economic condition and our overall condition. So I'll see you guys same time next week. Love y'all. Peace.